Welcome to the next video in Chapter 6 on Polynomials. We're in Section 6.5, and the title of it is Solving Polynomial Equations. But in order to understand how to solve polynomial equations, we need to actually talk a little bit more about factoring. Yes, our friend factoring is returning. I know when we talked about quadratic equations, there was a multitude of different ways to solve quadratic equations. Higher degree equations, some of those methods are going to come back. The biggest one, though, the factoring method that we started talking with quadratics about, where you set factors equal to zero, that's going to be the major method here. But I have to show you some tricks and some techniques to factor polynomials of higher degrees. There's three that your book shows you in this section, so this video is just going to be talking about the factoring component, and then in subsequent lessons and videos, we'll put that together and use these factors to physically solve the equation, okay? So first trick is the sum and difference of perfect cubes, okay? And there's two patterns to look at here. The first one, if you have two perfect cubes being added together, a cubed plus b cubed, then what you get is the following. You get two terms, a binomial and a trinomial. The binomial follows the pattern a plus b, and the trinomial follows the pattern a squared minus ab plus b squared. Now, when we take the difference of two perfect cubes, we also will get a binomial and a trinomial. These are slightly different, however. Their only difference will be in sign. So we start with a and b, but this time it's a minus b. Then our binomial, or our trinomial, excuse me, will also have the same three terms as before, a squared, ab, and b squared. But notice how there's now a plus sign in our first sign. So look at really all that's different. I'm going to just highlight a couple things here. The only thing that differs is the signs for these two patterns. Here's the way I always remember it. I memorize it. The pattern for the signs is same, opposite, plus. Here's what I mean by that. Once you get the five terms, used to the five terms of the pattern, and by the five terms I mean a, b, a squared, ab, and b squared, which unfortunately the best way to keep those down is to memorize them, then to figure out where the signs go, I use this trick. Same, as in the same sign as the original. See how in the first term it's a plus, because in the first pattern it's a cubed plus b cubed. Then I use the opposite for my second sign, so in the sum, I used minus, because that's the opposite. And then the third sign is always plus, so whether it's a sum or a difference, I'm always using a plus sign. So hopefully that will help, plus we're going to do a couple examples shortly, but we'll involve some numbers so you can see exactly how this works. So here's our first example. We're going to do x cubed minus 8. We're going to factor that. Okay, so let's think about what our a and what our b are. Now notice x cubed is a perfect cube, and 8 is also a perfect cube. So that's our a cubed and our b cubed. A is going to be x, because the cube root of x cubed is x. B will be the cube root of 8, which is 2. So now we're going to use our pattern, and I'm rewriting it here first to start out, a minus b times a squared plus ab plus b squared, and we'll plug in x for a and 2 for b. So our first factor is x minus 2. Our second factor will be a squared, which is now x squared, plus ab, which is 2x, and then b squared, which is 4, plus 4. So that is how we factor x cubed plus 8. Try another example, okay? Now we'll do a difference. X cubed plus 27, excuse me, a sum. X cubed plus 27, okay? X cubed is a perfect cube, naturally. 27 is also a perfect cube. It is, well, the cube root of 7, or excuse me, 27, is 3. So in the second example, we're going to use a to be x, and B will be 3. So we have x plus 3, because remember our first factor, we use the same sign as the original problem, so it's an x plus 3 this time. Then we do x squared, and then AB will be 3x, but we'll put a minus, because we always use the opposite sign from the problem, here. And then we do b squared, which is 9, so plus 9. Okay? Hopefully now you're starting to get the hang of it. Let's do one more that's a little bit more complicated. 27x cubed plus 64. All right. Are these both perfect cubes? Yes. A is now going to be 3x, because we have to see what cubed gets us 27, and also what cubed gets us x cubed, so it's 3x. And then the cube root of 64 is 4. So we'll use our pattern. We'll use 3x for A and 4 for B. So here we go. We get 3x plus 4 first, A plus B. Then we have to do A squared, which is 9x squared. Remember, you have to square both the 3 and the x. Then we do AB. That's 12x, so plus 12x. Actually, that should be minus 12x. Plus 16. One thing I forgot to notice, and I forgot to mention to you about this, and you want to take note of, that second term is a trinomial. And I know we've done a lot of practice with trinomials and factoring them, so you may ask yourself, hey, is this factorable? The answer is no. The trinomial is always prime. Okay? You have a couple practice problems now. Pause the video and give those a try. We'll discuss answers in class at a later date, as well as any questions you have about this, but that's the first of three patterns. All right, let's take a look at the second pattern, or method. This is probably the easiest because we've done it already. This is the grouping method. So this is if you have four terms. We pair up, and we take GCFs. So first example, 12a cubed minus 9a squared plus 4a minus 3. All right, first thing I do, I pair up the first two terms, I pair up the second two terms. Then within each set of parentheses that I just constructed, I ask myself, what are the GCFs? So self, what's the GCF of 12a cubed and 9a squared? Well, I believe it's 3a squared, so I will factor that out of just the first two terms. So I get 3a squared, and then I take left out 4a, and minus 3. So that's what stays inside. Now I do the same thing with the second pair. So I say to myself, self, what's the GCF of 4a minus 3? Well, there isn't anything. So as we've talked about before, when there is no GCF, we take out a 1. And we leave the 4a minus 3. Now look at how nifty this is. We have the same thing in both sets of parentheses. So we pull out the outside numbers and write one set of parentheses for that. So we get 3a squared plus 1 as our first factor. And then our second factor is 4a minus 3. Okay? Let's look at the second example. 35xy minus 5x minus 56y plus 8. So again, we'll pair up the first set and the second set and take out GCFs. So 35xy and negative 5x has a GCF of 5x. So we'll write that out in front. And when we divide that through, we get 7y minus 1. Now negative 56y and positive 8. The GCF is 8, but remember, I want to make what's left over look like this. So instead of taking out a positive 8, I'll take out a negative 8, because then I'm left with a positive 7y minus 1. Now again, outside numbers become one pair of parentheses. Inside numbers become the other. And that is your other factor. Okay? You have a couple examples of this one. Give this a try. All right, last factoring technique in this section is what's called quadratic form. So what we're going to do is we're going to look at some higher degree polynomials that sort of have the appearance of being a quadratic, but they have a higher degree than degree 2. Basically, the general form is something like this. X to the 2n plus x to the n plus c. Okay, and there could be coefficients in front of those x's as well. Really, it's ax and bx for those two terms. Here's what I mean by that. So we'll start with a basic example. X to the 4th plus x squared minus 12. Okay, that's what we're going to factor. I'm going to kind of segue, though, and do something familiar to that. Doesn't this kind of look like this quadratic function? X squared plus x minus 12? Look at the problem on the right and think about how you'd factor that. Just take a couple seconds and think about that. Okay, so remember, we want two things that multiply to negative 12 and add to 1. And they would be negative 3 and positive 4. So our factors here would be x plus 4 and x minus 3. Well, guess what? When we're dealing with a fourth degree, as we have on the left, in what's quadratic form, we're going to do the same kind of technique. But instead of putting in x's, like we did here, we're going to put in x squareds. So our two factors are x squared plus 4 and x squared minus 3. Notice the numbers, the way I came up with these numbers isn't any different than I did here. The only difference is I have x squareds in my first term because we need to break down the x to the 4th. Went a little fast there. We want to break down that x to the 4th, and the way we do it is by putting x squared instead of x and x. All right, we'll look at one more example like this. A little trickier. So 5x to the 4th minus 9x squared plus 4. Okay? So this one, you have a number in front of the first term. You have that 5, so we've got to use the grouping method. So remember, we have to come up with two things that multiply to AC, which is 20, and add to B, which is negative 9. I'm going to do this one a little slower because I think this kind of factoring is the one we struggled with quadratics, so I want to make sure we don't struggle with it in fourth degree. All right, so two numbers that multiply to 20 and add to negative 9. They are negative 5 and negative 4. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to rewrite the middle term, this minus 9x squared, using those numbers. So I get 5x to the 4th minus 5x squared minus 4x squared plus 4. And then I group. And then I'm going to take out GCFs the way I just did a few minutes ago in the video. So I take out a 5x squared from the first, and I'm left with x squared minus 1. I take out a GCF of the next two, and I get minus 4, x squared minus 1. I pull them together, 5x squared minus 4, x squared minus 1. But we're not done. Look at the x squared minus 1. Does anybody remember what special pattern that falls into? This is a difference of perfect squares. X squared is a perfect square. 1 is a perfect square. And here's the pattern for that. It's a minus b, a plus b. So if a squared is x squared, a is x. If b squared is 1, then b is 1. We fill that in. And the complete factorization for this polynomial looks a little something like this. 5x squared minus 4 times x minus 1 times x plus 1. Okay? So the key to this example is, even if you follow the quadratic form method, because now we're dealing with x squareds instead of x's, occasionally we run into this issue that we could factor down further into linear factors. It won't always be the case. The 5x squared minus 4 isn't factorable, so we can stop there. But in the case of what's highlighted in pink, we can go further. So you have to always ask yourself, am I done or can I do more? Okay? With that, you have a few more practice problems. I know this was a little bit of a lengthier video, but thank you for sticking with it. There's a lot in this section, and we'll continue with it as we go forward. Have a great evening. If you have any questions, as always, make sure you bring them to class.